Thank you. Hello and welcome to this meeting today. We're so glad that you've been able to join us. We do hope that you've had a good Christmas, and we'd like to say Happy New Year to you all. We hope that this year is going to be much better than 2020. I'm here with Anthony, my husband, and I'm also here with Colonels Paul and Janine Main, our new Chief Secretary and Territorial Secretary for Leader Development. Really good to see you.
Thank you. It's good to be here. Yeah.
So today we begin looking at covenant. This will give us an opportunity to recognise once again all that God has done for us, and in return all that we are able to do for him and with him through the Holy Spirit. But before we do that, we're going to sing a carol together because it is still the Christmas season. And for those of you that like to use your songbook, it's number 113. And we're going to sing Joy to the World, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing. So wherever you are, wherever you're sitting today, I invite you to join and sing as loud as you like in your own homes, and we'll lift up praises to the Lord together. We hope that you enjoyed singing that lovely carol today. Let me just remind you of the very last line of the last verse of the carol, and wonders of his love. That leads us really nicely into our prayer time today. And in a moment, we're going to be led in family prayers by Captains Rachel and Dylan Nevelt and their family. But before they do that for us, we're going to listen to a beautiful song entitled Everywhere. Words that are so familiar perhaps to many of you listening in today. Have you ever stopped to think how God loves you? It sounds quite incredible, and yet it's true. And as you listen and reflect this morning, may you know in a very real sense, wherever you are, that you are wrapped completely in the love of God.
Have you ever stopped to think how God loves you? It sounds quite incredible, and yet it's true. Nothing on this earth or in the heavens above is as sure and certain as God's love. Oh, it's as fine as the sky, and it's as deep as the sea, and it's as wide. Thank you.
Father God, thank you for being a faithful God, for you never leave us and you never abandon us. Thank you for your powerful presence in our lives. We are assured that your heart is turned towards us, that your eyes watch over us, and that your ears are open to all of our prayers. We celebrate as you bring us into this new year, because we look forward to all that it has in store for us. Without you, we would surely fail, but with you, there is great hope. And that is why we want to commit our lives to you afresh today.
Dear Lord, thank you for always being with us, even when it was locked, when we were locked at home because of coronavirus. Keep us safe in this new year, and please help us to be able to see family and friends again soon.
Dear Lord Jesus, the last year has been difficult because our island borders have been locked down, and I've not been able to see all my family. I pray for protection over my friends and family, and for a successful vaccine to fight back against coronavirus. Please be with my mum and dad, and all the leaders in the Salvation Army who are working hard. Give them your peace and your strength.
Dear Lord, we thank you for helping us to make it through this past year. We pray that you'll make us strong and courageous for the road ahead. We pray, Holy Spirit, that you'll lead us each step of the way throughout this new year, with whatever we face. We ask that you will guide us and help us to live in such a way that reflects your nature. And may we be aware of how much we need you and need your grace and your strength and your power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'm not afraid to. We're so grateful to the Hedge End Worship Group for singing that song for us. I love that song. When I was lost, you came and rescued me. Well, two people who, well, weren't lost, but have certainly come back to the United Kingdom with the Republic of Ireland Territory are Paul and Janine Main, Colonels. We are delighted that they've joined us, not only in this meeting, but they've joined us back in the territory. You're not strangers to us at all, but you have been away. I mean, where have you been?
Yeah, we've been in the sunshine. We've spent 2.5 years in the Caribbean, living in Jamaica, but travelling between the 16 countries of that territory.
16 countries. Yeah, yeah.
16 countries, yeah. 10 currencies, yeah. 4 different languages. So yeah, we've come back to the frozen UK at the moment.
A very complicated place to be in the Caribbean by the sound of it. And I know a lot of people think, oh, Caribbean, that must have been wonderful, but I'm sure it's had its challenges, and there's some things you've probably learnt along the way as you went away for those 2 years. Would that be right?
Absolutely. I think the need, the deep faith that the people have, the disasters that come naturally through hurricanes, that the whole corridor, yeah, of the Caribbean. Just before we left, I had the privilege of going to visit the relief following Hurricane Dorian, and the tremendous impact of that natural disaster, but also how communities gather together in adversity. Yeah. So lots of highlights, lots of issues, resources, very poor territory, but it was a huge privilege.
Yeah. Well, you were in our thoughts and prayers as you were in that part of the world. And it does remind us actually of many other reinforcement officers and personnel around the world today. And I think we should just acknowledge that and bless them, because I know many of them will be tuning in and watching us today. So wherever you are in the world, God bless you all. But Paul and Jean, you've come back. That's the great thing. And we're so pleased that you're working with Jill and I and with the wider territory. But Janine, you know, you've been around, if I could say it like that, you've been around for a long time, haven't you? You've had several appointments, many appointments. I mean, when were you commissioned and where have you been before you went to Jamaica?
We were commissioned in 1986, so we've been officers 34 years. Wow. We had a number of corps appointments in the northwest area, Liverpool, North Wales, the Isle of Man, then down to South Wales, in the divisional headquarters, then across to London, where we've been in THQ, and I had a corps appointment in Upper Norwood, and then divisional leaders. And then Paul came back to THQ, and I remained as a divisional leader, and then the appointment to the Caribbean, which, as you've stated, sounded very exotic, but was far from exotic when we got there, and was very... Yes, very different to what we expected. It's been a great experience in the sense of opening our eyes and broadening our horizons. We've seen the Salvation Army that we didn't know existed, and it's been a great challenge, but huge opportunities too.
So you're not strangers to the United Kingdom territory, to everyone who's kind of like watching us from the UK and from the Republic of Ireland. You're well known and well loved, and we're delighted that you're with us.
Thank you.
But all of that service, all of that work that you've done, of course, was all done in the name of Jesus. Can you just tell us a little bit, I mean, we haven't got that long, but a little bit about, you know, your experience of knowing Jesus from perhaps an early age? I don't know, maybe it was as children, or maybe it was later in life that you came to know the Lord. Can you maybe just tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah. I'm grateful for the upbringing I had from godly parents and the legacy that they give you, but also you have to make that personal, don't you? And the people who have shown Jesus to me and revealed his character that informs me and helps me to grow. I think the experience in the Caribbean with people living in poverty, but their faith really strong, like every day they bless the Lord for that day. Yeah. And I think that's something that I've been reminded, the need that every day is a new day, every day God uses us, and every day he provides for us. One of my favourite songs is King of Kings, Majesty, God of Heaven, living in me, which is incredible to think about, that he takes us and our limitations as well as our giftings and uses them for the kingdom. And 34 years, I've marvelled at how he's used me, often in my weakness, but he's made me strong. So I'm just grateful for that kind of living daily experience of him.
Yes, I've been a Christian for a long time. I remember at a Corps Cadet house party where God came to me in a very special way. I was 14 and I really felt that was a baptism in the Holy Spirit, really, that experience. And since then, a faith that's deepened, just great example of parents that showed me how to live that way. And I think just now it's just an ever deepening faith. Yeah. Every day God is just revealing more of himself to me, and I just know him as my shepherd.
Yeah.
That he never leaves me, and he leads me every step of the way, and even through the dark valleys I don't need to fear because he is with me and I dwell in his house forever. Yeah. That's my experience, that's my testimony, and I'm just deeply in love with Jesus and just want that to be an ever deepening relationship.
Yeah. I'm sure that'll be a real encouragement to many people who are watching this morning, the shepherd leading us and going with him. Thanks so much for sharing that. Going forward into 2021, as we've now arrived there at last, hopes and aspirations for this next period of time?
Being a little bit more free than we've been in 2020. Reconnecting with family and friends. For me, getting my head around all that's going on within in the territory, but hopefully opportunity to get out and be with people and in ministry with people, building relationships, reconnecting. That's what we've missed during COVID, but embracing what God's doing and walking alongside and joining the team, being part of this great UK team. It's been incredible just reading Salvationists or watching social media about what's been going on while we've been away, just reconnecting with that. And God's not finished with us yet. I really do believe that.
Janine, anything you want to add to that?
Great opportunities, great challenges ahead, I'm absolutely sure. And I've had having lots of conversations with people, and I feel like I'm turning the pieces of the jigsaw over, so I'm beginning to see the picture. And I truly believe then there'll be an opportunity to perhaps put those pieces together a little bit. That's exciting to feel that we can do that in some way, just a small way perhaps. But and just working with both of you and the rest of the team, it's very exciting for me, and I feel lots of hope for 2021.
Yeah, that's lovely. Paul and Janine, you know, normally we would have an official formal installation. Might have been at William Booth College or at Regent Hall or another venue up and down the territory. We can't do that, obviously. But today we're joined by so many people across the UK and the Republic of Ireland, but actually right around the world, which is just lovely. They're joining with us. And I'm going to say a prayer for you to mark the official start of your ministry in the roles that you have. I know that you've been doing that for a few weeks already, but how appropriate at the start of the new year that we can do that together.
Thank you.
So as I pray, I'm sure you'll know that many other people will be praying for you and with you, and we'll do so as we go forward together in covenant today.
Thank you.
Let's pray, shall we? Gracious Lord, our loving Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for Paul and Janine. Thank you, Father, that you have called them, you've equipped them, and you've enabled them in all the appointments that have been theirs as they have followed you as officers of the Salvation Army. And I pray, gracious Lord, as they pick up their new responsibilities, that the Holy Spirit would come and infill them afresh, anoint them and empower them for the ministries that are opening up to them. I pray, gracious Lord, as they join and as they are blessed by so many other people around about them, that they themselves would know your presence and be able to reflect that even more powerfully into the lives of all who they will touch not only in their public ministry, but in their administration too. So, Father, we commit them to you and ask, Father, your blessing upon them in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Well, following that prayer, we're going to have a reading which is really appropriate for Paul and Janine, but for all of us. And it's a reading from Ephesians, and it's going to be read by Hyung, who's a soldier at the Regent Hall Corps, but also an employee here at Territorial Headquarters.
I'll be reading from the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 8 to 22. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and has destroyed the barrier, the dividing wall of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who are far away, and peace to those who are near. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. Consequently, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens of God's people and also members of his household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. In him, the whole building is joined together and rises to become a holy temple in the Lord. And in him, you two are being built together to become a dwelling in which God lives by his Spirit.
Well, we thank the band for that beautiful piece of music. Well, 2021 has finally arrived. I was thinking that surely 2020 must be the longest year on record since records began, quite frankly. Although I have to be honest, at other times it seems the last few months have gone by so very, very quickly. It seems just a few weeks since we were in this place preparing for Easter, and here we are now in January. Well, we have another year ahead of us, and while commencing with great hope, as we know now that the vaccines are being rolled out, no one knows what 2021 will hold for us, for the world, for our families, for our communities, for our core, and for our lives individually. One thing, however, that I'm certain of is that as we go forward, God has this. And he has you and he has me. He's right in the midst of us. He is Emmanuel, God who is with us. It's what we've been celebrating over this Christmastide. And as we enter this new year, I think it's timely that we remind ourselves that he has chosen to invite you and me into a covenant relationship with him. Now, covenant is not a word or a term that we use that frequently. And consequently, I think we could be in danger of losing the significance and the power that flows from our covenantal relationship with God. Interestingly, covenant is not only referenced all the way through the Old and the New Testaments, it's what the Bible is all about. In fact, that's what testament means, the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. And although covenant is not explained in the Bible, it's there all the time. It's the backdrop to everything. It's like the staging or the scenery of a theatre. In the Old Testament, there are 285 references to covenant, and there are 33 in the New Testament. It may not be so easy to get our heads round this concept and experience because we no longer live in a covenant-making world like the people of the Old and the New Testaments did. Having said that, there are remnants of such thinking that are still with us, almost vestiges, leftovers from a previous age. Many of us are familiar with marriage being a covenant. Some of us are aware of deeds of covenant, such as building covenants. And of course, prior to gift aid, the relationship with the Inland Revenue, with our giving, was a deed of covenant. Of course, many of you will be familiar with the covenant that you signed when you became a soldier of the Salvation Army, the Articles of War, now known as the Soldiers' Covenant. And many people will be aware that all soldiers who become officers, who enter into an officer's covenant, are covenanted people, Salvation Army officers. So even today, we see around us the legacy of a bygone age that ran on covenant. And if only we could grasp something of the meaning and the riches of covenant, I suggest that our lives will be transformed. And I suggest we will find untapped spiritual resources to enable us to live out the lives that have called, God has called of us to be disciples of Jesus Christ. So over the next few weeks, for those core who choose to go deeper, there are resources available which will explore some of the major covenants that are recorded in Scripture. But today, allow me to give you a sense of the critical importance for us all to appreciate what covenant is. So what is covenant? Well, one definition would say that a covenant is a contract or an agreement between two parties. The parties might involve, might be individuals, families, states, kings, or even God himself. The parties might be on the same level, i.e. two families, two kings, with mutual obligations agreed upon each other freely. Or they might be on different levels, God and human beings, a large empire and a small nation. And sometimes the stronger party might impose conditions on the weaker party, obedience, taxes, tribute, those kind of things, in exchange for certain benefits, protection, for example. In covenant, there may be promises of specific benefits, rewards, or blessings for the people who keep the terms of the covenant, but also the threat of sanctions, punishment, or even curses for people who break the terms. Between the contracting parties, symbols or signs might be exchanged to remind the two parties about the agreement that they've entered. In the Authorized Version of the New Testament, the Greek word diathake was translated as testament, testamentum in Latin. But covenant is actually the better translation, as in later translations, because covenant in Latin means a coming together, a covenire. And in the Old Testament, berith is the Hebrew word that is translated as covenant. Now, berith has its root from a word which means to cut. Hence, a covenant is always cut. It's a cutting because once the agreement was made, it was sealed and it was ratified by the killing of animals in a ritualistic but very symbolic and meaningful way. And that will be referenced later in the month when we consider the Abrahamic covenant in a future meeting. Thus, the covenant is marked by a solemn bond between the two parties, and it was literally written in red. Listen to the Liverpool Walton Songsters as they sing that beautiful song, written in red.
God wrote his love on a hillside.
I love you. That's what Calvary says, written in red. Here's a hypothetical example of covenant. And I want to reference Reverend Mike Breen, one-time rector of St. Thomas's at Sheffield, who spoke at Roots very powerfully on this subject quite a few years ago. He told this story. Here's how covenant might work. Tribe A is of 500 people and is approached by Tribe B of 1,000 people with a view of making a pact, with a view to making a covenant. And they would agree together that they would stand together, that if Tribe C turned up and tried to attack either A or B, they could depend on each other to support one another. The resources of both tribes would now be available to each other. All the animals, all the men, and all the women would be available to both tribes. So instead of two tribes, in a sense, effectively, they became as one. They would share everything they had in covenant. One, for example, might have been a goat herder. And because they were herding goats, led by, let's say, Chief Windsor, and perhaps the other tribe, a richer tribe, were herding, say, cattle, they are led by, let's say, Mountbatten. Now, together, this combined covenanted tribe of 1,500 people with all their goats and with all their cows, another tribe would seriously have to look out if they had secret designs upon either A or B. If they were planning to take them into slavery or destruction, they better watch out, because now all the resources of this now one tribe now belongs to each other. Now, to seal the covenant, they would take a heifer, and they would perhaps take a ram, and perhaps a goat, and they would butcher them, and they would cut them in half. And the halves of these animals would be laid out in a long kind of corridor between the two tribes. And one leader of one tribe would walk towards the other through this corridor of the animals that had been slaughtered. And they would walk from one end to the other, and then the other tribe leader would walk from his end to the other end. They would cross, and they would have their covenant bound together through the blood, swapping places with each other. They had effectively, you see, became one. Their names were now put together. So effectively, one became Windsor Mountbatten, and the other became known as Mountbatten-Windsor, so that everybody knew that they belonged together. Now, you can read about this and about Abraham entering into a covenant, not with another tribe, but with God in Genesis chapter 15. And I'm not going to give you too much detail about that, because you may have the opportunity in a week's or so time to explore that and to go deeper. Although this relationship between Abraham and God is clearly not two equal parties, of course, between man and God, it follows the same pattern. Symbolic changing of places, sealed with blood, joining together of name. Abraham becomes Abraham, and the sign of the covenant was sealed with a cutting. Every male was to undergo circumcision, for this, the scripture says, will be the sign of covenant among you. So Abraham enters into a covenant with a God who says, you will be mine and I will be yours. I will walk with you and you shall walk with me. And as you walk in obedience, I will be with you and with your children and your children's children. Effectively saying, all you have, I shall have, and all I have shall be yours. All the resources of heaven available to you. Guess what? That terrible, nauseating Sunday school song, which was doing the rounds many years ago when I was a young officer. I don't know whether you guys would remember this. Father Abraham has many sons. I am one of them, and so are you. So let's all praise the Lord. Right arm, left leg, and all the rest of it. Some of you will remember that. But it ends up with saying, I am one of them. I am one of the sons, one of the daughters of Abraham. You see, we are the inheritors of the covenant, a covenant that says we belong to him and he to us. I will walk with you and you will walk with me. All I have, says God, I shall have, and all I have shall be yours. As you walk in obedience, I will be with you and your children and your children's children. Now, throughout the Bible, we read time and time again of God renewing the covenant. In Jeremiah, for example, we read that Father God is going to enter into a new covenant. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. Jeremiah 31, 31. It's an easy one to remember. We can look that one up. And in Ezekiel 36, 36, also a good one to remember, we read the prophetic words that God will give us a new heart and put a new spirit in us. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh, and I will put my spirit in you. And ultimately, we discover that covenant, this relationship between God and man, is fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ himself. I contend that if we understand the concept of covenant, we'll understand the Bible so much better, and we will appreciate Jesus even more. The great covenant events of the Bible are all heading towards the coming of Jesus, his life, which is supreme, but his life which isn't just about revelation, revealing the Father nature to us. It's so much more than that. It's also about example, about teaching, about sacrifice and atonement. We understand all of that, but all of those aspects, and then when his life and his death and resurrection are seen through a lens of covenant, it all begins to make much more wonderful, powerful sense. It's why the narrative of the birth and life of Jesus Christ are contained in a new book, the New Testament, the New Covenant. It's why Jesus is described as the mediator of the new covenant. Hebrews chapter 9, verses 11 through to 15. It's why at the Last Supper, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." Luke 22, verse 19. It's why in Ephesians, Paul wrote and explained that we all together are invited into covenant with Christ. You remember the reading we had earlier in our meeting. Therefore, remember that formerly you who are Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, that done in the body by the hands of men, remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenant of the promise, without hope, without God in the world. But listen to this. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ. It's written in red, the covenant sealed for us. You see, we're invited into a covenant with him. And now we're invited to go forward together as a covenanted people. In these days, at the start of 2021, consciously, intentionally, we're invited to renew our covenant or to enter into covenant for the first time with him by simply saying, "Lord, all I have is yours," and discover at the same time that God is saying, "All I have is given to you." God needs the Salvation Army. He needs his church to walk forward in solemn yet joyful covenant with him for his glory, for his praise, in order that we might increasingly become the people he called and raised us up to be. Covenant, you see, I think is amongst the best news we have ever received. Let me conclude by explaining something that you know. God has eternal life, yes? He is immortal. On the other hand, we as human beings face death and are mortal. Here's the deal, which is almost too good to be true. In covenant with God, in this coming together, in this exchanging of places, we give our life up to Him and He gives His life to us. Now, I don't know when you see an amazing offer. There are plenty of offers going around at the moment up and down our beleaguered high streets, but you're never going to get a deal like this. This is the deal. He gets our life that ends in death, and we get His life that ends in eternity. How great is that, really? He gets my life that should end in death, but I get His life that ends in eternity. How do we know that? We know that because Christ died. He gave His life on the cross. And because He died, we know we get His life. It is written in red. He says to us, "You give me your life that is marked and tarnished by sin, which should end in death, and you will receive my life." You see, the blood of Christ is shed for us, in the sense that it is the payment for our sins. He dies in our place. This is an amazing culmination of the eternal covenant that has been running throughout all the pages of Scripture. It's as if the shadow of the cross has been cast across all the years of history, that everything has been moving towards a point where not only we would know personal liberty and freedom from our sins, but not only that, that we could know cleansing and now empowering of the Holy Spirit within us. But now that we, you and I, could become part of the eternal covenant with God, who says, "Welcome. You don't need to stay a foreigner to the covenant anymore. What you have will be mine, and what I have is yours. You'll be a new people, changed from within. You will actually have Christ by His Spirit living in you. His name will be joined to yours. You will be known as Christian, as Christian. But even more than having His name, you will have Him. The covenant will be written upon your hearts, not engraved on stone. This covenant, this coming together, will be sealed with the blood of Christ, written in red." Now, when we understand covenant in this sense, it changes everything for me. It helps us to understand and appreciate that God is truly Emmanuel, the one who is with us. It helps us to understand why and how He is able to help us at every turn of our lives and every step of the way. It helps us to understand that heaven is not simply a destination. It's an eternal experience to increasingly be enjoyed now, today, now, right in the midst of this pandemic, right at the start of 2021. It helps us understand that our relationship with a loving, covenant-making God must impact our relationships with fellow believers and with all who are part of the covenant. We are family. Understanding covenant means that this understanding of togetherness means that we must be together in the service of Father God, of course, but it means too that we are in the service of this created world for which we have a covenanted responsibility. It is God's world in which we have been called to be salt and light and love, in order that boys and girls and men and women of every nation and tribe should have the opportunity to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, with Paul, I say, in Ephesians chapter 3, verse 14, "For this reason, for all of this, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name, and I pray that out of His glorious riches He may strengthen you now with power through His Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's people to know, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us as a covenanted people, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen?
Amen.
Yes. Amen. Now, it's likely that in the weeks ahead, your core may be exploring further the beauty of covenant. And this will move towards an opportunity to renew or to enter into a covenant relationship with God in the weeks ahead. But even today, as we sing some verses, you may choose to make your prayer of covenant wherever you are. As we listen and as we sing, you'll come to the words of the chorus of Song 634. By the love that never ceased to hold me, by the blood that thou did shed for me, while thy presence and thy power enfold me, I renew my covenant with thee.
Shall we pray together?
Father God, we thank you for your love that never ceases to hold us, and for the bond, the covenant, that neither life nor death can break. We put our trust in you today as we make this new covenant with you in this new year. We thank you for this opportunity, for every day is a new day with you, but at the beginning of this new year, to think once again of all that you give us in this covenant and what we in return can bring to you, and we offer you our lives. We offer you every part of ourselves so that in this new year we go forward in double strength. We go forward in your strength, in our weakness, and nothing can come between us. Lord, we thank you for your promises, for your covenant with us. And we pray now that as we step into this new year, that we will have the confidence that it brings, that you bring to us, to walk forward and to know that you are always with us. Lord, we thank you for the message that we've heard. And we thank you, Lord, for all that we can receive from you as we go forward now in covenant, living in that covenant with you. We make this prayer in your precious name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now we're going to join together in our final song. It's song number 241, if you like to sing. And we hope you will sing. These words will be so familiar to you. I draw your attention to the first two lines of the last verse that says, "No condemnation now I dread. Jesus and all in him is mine." What a covenant. Let's sing together.
Thank you.
What a great song to finish our worship together. Thank you for joining with us. That's that line, alive in him. I pray that that will be so for all of us as we face this new year. Our thanks for joining with us. Our thanks to those who've contributed to our worship this morning so helpfully. And our thanks too to the video production team here at THQ who again have given us so helpful expert help. Thank you for helping us communicate to the territory. So let me pray with you as we conclude our worship this morning. Father, I thank you for this day. I thank you for the opportunity to come together on this Sunday in this new year to praise you and to be reminded of our covenant. Be alive within us, we pray. Take us forward into this new year with hope and with peace. And may you do immeasurably more in us than we can ever hope or imagine. Thank you for the promise that you're with us. And so we make ourselves available to you. So go with us, God. Strengthen us. And may your peace rest in us, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
God bless you.